Which country? That's still in Canada.
Yeah, that's still in Canada.
This man went from being a billionaire to becoming broke. Oh, yeah, you heard me right. He was a millionaire with nice cars and a nice house, living in an affluent area with a lot of money. Not only that, he owned his companies and also worked for major companies in the world, including Toyota and many more. His wife worked on the most popular movie known as The Boy Who Harnessed the Wind on Netflix. But now, he has become a mobile billboard. Due to cancer exacerbated his life, he sold everything he owned. Everything changed for him today, and his life is now very different.
Like now, I know I'm a farmer. I'm going to be a farmer. I'm planning to be a farmer. I'm doing to be a farmer. You'll be surprised. One of the biggest problems I came through was a problem of debt. I had some debts which I was unable to pay, and they kept on growing. And that brought a lot of stress. And you know, one of the things about cancer is, by the way, it's caused by stress.
His life was brimming with valuable lessons that eventually inspired him to pen a book about the remarkable journey he had experienced.
So this and this, after the operation at Nairobi Hospital in 2013, this is when I was attending radiotherapy in India. This is a hospital called Medanta.
We encountered numerous individuals who once enjoyed wealth, but then found themselves grappling with adversity. If it's not the first time you've watched our videos, you may know a woman called Dorcas from Kenya. She went from being a millionaire then, becoming very poor, to the point where she was left homeless. Similarly, there's the story of Beatrice, who had a luxurious life in America, but later returned to her native Kenya, only to experience extreme poverty. These stories highlight the ups and downs that people can encounter on the path of life. But for this man, it is very different because he has a unique, difficult life that led him to write a book about his life. I even read this book myself, and I bet at the end of this video, you will be curious to read his book too. This is the story of a man who went from being a billionaire to selling books in the street.
My name is Richard Kioko Kiundi, also called the Duke of Emali, a beautiful town somewhere along Mombasa Road in Makueni County.
Richard's upbringing was in a modest family, but a fortunate opportunity allowed him to attend a quality school in Kenya. His life story unfolded much like that of many other young men. He went through the usual experiences, attending high school and eventually earning his university degree. It was when he embarked on his journey into the working world that the tale of his life truly began.
The time I spent at the university, my experiences at the University of Nairobi, of course after the high school ones, how I was employed in the civil service. I did my bit in various districts of Kilifi and Taita Taveta, and I was transferred to Kisii. And one time, as I was doing something, I came on duty from Taita Taveta to Nairobi, and then in the evening, I went for a drink at Nairobi West. There was a bar called Jean's Bar. I don't know if it's still there. And over a drink, I found a friend who was working in Nairobi, an accountant like myself, but he was much older. As we were discussing, I told him I would never work in Nairobi because it is too expensive. And he asked me jokingly, how much would you be paid to come to Nairobi? And that time I was in Jobur J, I was getting about 4,500 shillings per month. So I quoted a salary four times that. I said, if I get 4,500 times four, that was roughly about 18,000. I'll come to work in Nairobi. This gentleman told me, come to my office tomorrow morning at Toyota Kenya. It's at around about Nyayo National Roundabout. Nyayo Stadium, National Stadium Roundabout. And I went to the office and I got a job. So I came to Nairobi.
Once Richard began his job at Toyota Kenya, he found himself enjoying his work immensely. His impeccable conduct and innovative contributions made his time there truly enjoyable. His life took a turn for the better. He was a husband and father of two, and his newfound financial stability allowed him to provide for his family comfortably. Furthermore, he experienced personal growth and development, steadily climbing the career ladder as he earned promotions day by day.
I joined Toyota Kenya in 1987. As an assistant accountant. And over time, I was promoted because of some of the innovations that I was able to introduce in how things were being done at the company. So that by 1992, I was promoted to be chief accountant of one of the divisions, which was called Yamaha. Yamaha division, which was dealing with Yamaha motorbikes. Again, as I said in the book, I have put a lot of those details. Later on, I was promoted as the operations manager in another division called Rhino Motors, which was based at Hurlingham, actually where there is the Java today, the petrol station. That used to be Rhino Motors, and I was a general manager for that. Then after a while, I decided to change jobs. Or rather, I got an opportunity because I was finding the pressure in the private sector was too much. It was beginning to affect my health. And so I wanted to change to something less strenuous. So I resigned from Toyota Kenya in February, at the end of January 1995. And then again, one of those interesting things, I went for a drink in a place where we used to meet friends somewhere off Ngong Road. Off Jogo Road, called Hamza. There's a bar there called Muingo wa Kaiti. It means across a certain river in Ukambani called Kaiti. It's a famous river. And it belonged to some people who come from that area. So I went there in the afternoon for a drink and I found another friend. And as we were talking, I told him I resigned from work the previous month. This was around the 2nd or 3rd of February. And he worked for Kenya Pipeline. He was the operations manager for Kenya Pipeline. He told me, we're looking for an accountant. If you want a job, I can connect you to the chief accountant. That's how I got my second job. So the first job I got from a bar in Nairobi West. This second one I'm getting from a bar.
In Jogo Road.
Yeah, on Jogo Road. I found it very interesting. Anyway, so I joined Pipeline and I worked. I joined Pipeline as an accountant 3, yeah. Accountant 2. I can't remember exactly, but I was job group 7. And again, I used my knowledge to change a lot of things, that the way things are done in Kenya Pipeline, because I was put in accounting for oil products. And I changed the way it is done. Again, I've detailed that in the book. And I was promoted so fast that by 1999, I was chief accountant, job group 3. And then I was transferred to head office in charge of statutory matters, you know, taxes and salaries and all that. And then something happened and I was removed from my job. I think in February 2003.
At a certain point, health issues forced Richard to put a pause on his career, but it's important to note that his professional journey had seen continuous progress thanks to his outstanding conduct and performance. Before he set out on his life's journey in Nairobi, Richard already had a family, a loving wife, and their first child. However, it was in Nairobi that life began to improve even further, bringing the blessing of a second child. As a dedicated family man, Richard's aim was to provide a comfortable and prosperous life for his loved ones. Through his diligent work, he achieved just that. His generous salary enabled him to acquire not one, not two, but 3 cars and a beautiful home. Additionally, his 4 children were able to attend prestigious, high-quality schools. Richard's wisdom and insight made him a role model for many around him. People admired and sought to emulate his exemplary qualities. But as life sometimes unpredictably unfolds, there are moments when we have little control over its course. Unfortunately, Richard's health issues became an obstacle, preventing him from continuing on the path he had diligently forged.
That was in 2013. Actually, 2013 was not a very good year for me. One of the days early in the year, as I was walking around Nairobi, I got a pain in my chest. And I got into a clinic and I was told, after being checked, the ECGs and all that, I was told to quickly, actually what the doctor said is, she asked me, do you have a personal doctor? I said, yes, because I'm diabetic, I have a doctor. I said, doctor, what you do now? Check yourself to a big hospital and call your doctor. So of course I panicked. This was in Midtown, so I grabbed a cab. I went to Nairobi Hospital and fortunately also my doctor was around there. So I went to him, to her, and told her what I've been told. And she referred me to a cardiologist. The cardiologist did a small test at his clinic, which is also in the same place, Doctor's Plaza, and he immediately admitted me in HDU. Apparently, I was having a mild stroke. That was in February 2013. So I was in HDU for 3 days, and then the general ward, private ward, yeah, but you know, where are the other people? For 5 days, I spent 7 days in hospital. Then later on in March, the same thing happened again. This time I spent 5 days in HDU and another 5 days in the ward. And I was advised to change my lifestyle. I was overweight. I was about 95, between 95 and 98 kgs. I was very heavy. So I was advised, now, those are warnings. And the doctor told me I'm lucky I got the warning because I got away from it. So I started a regime of diet and exercise and all that. Then in October, I started having upset stomachs. And I had become very sensitive about my health. So I went to see another doctor. I went to local hospitals and I would be given medication. And, you know, once the medication is finished, two weeks down the line, the same problem again. So I went and consulted a stomach, what are they called? The stomach doctors. She's called Dr. Musau. And she did a colonoscopy and an endoscopy, and they found something growing in my stomach. They took it out and they found it was cancer, stage 1B. She told me I'm one of the luckiest patients she ever seen, because stomach cancer has no symptoms and they usually find it when it's too late. She told me at 1B to be managed.
That's how he started his journey with cancer. He went for an operation at Nairobi Hospital, and a few days later, things became worse. The next step in his journey led him to seek treatment in India, a country known for its advanced medical facilities. But there was a significant hurdle to overcome: the substantial cost of his treatment. Unfortunately, his insurance refused to cover the expenses, citing that they did not provide coverage for chronic diseases. To make matters even more challenging, he had started a company of his own after leaving his previous job. To finance his treatment, he had to make the painful decision to sell this company. This not only created significant financial difficulties for him and his family, but also presented a host of unforeseen problems.
One of the biggest problems I came through was a problem of debt. I had some debts which I was unable to pay, and they kept on growing. And that brought a lot of stress. And you know, one of the things about cancer is, by the way, it's caused by stress. If your lifestyle is stressful, you are heading for cancer. There's no question about it. So now it was a bit of a problem that I have debts. People want to auction me. In fact, I was auctioned at one point. We had three cars, they were auctioned. They wanted to auction the house.
What is auction?
They are sold by you know, they are repossessed. You know, the financier comes and takes your stuff and goes and sells them.
We had the three cars.
So they were taken
at a go.
They were taken at a go, and they were sold at very low prices. So we even were left with a debt. I was left with a debt, not we, because it is me. My family was not in the debt. That was my business. So that has been a major struggle. I have not yet finished paying the debt. There are still some I'm working on.
Throughout his illness, Richard had to confront rumors and challenges that occasionally originated from within his own family. However, as a wise and strong man, he chose to simply disregard them.
But there are some extended family members who apparently, either from jealousy or whatnot, spread the stories that I was dead, I was going to die, you know, and it's some people I've valued for a very long time. Fortunately, my immediate family, my brothers and sisters and their children, are all together with me. In fact, they visited me one time. We had a major session in my home in Garden Estate. And that gave me a lot of motivation and the determination to live, because this love that I'm being shown by the family, how can I let them down? I will not let them down. Actually, it's a stupid thing, because it's got something to do with the property at home. The land we live in belonged to my grandfather. So one of the things I had processed, my grandfather, that's my father, was the first one, and he had five other brothers. So one of the things I had suggested was to subdivide the total property among the six sons, so that everybody can get their own title deed, because the title is one, and incidentally, it's in my mother's name, because by that time my father had already died. So it was registered in the name of the first family, and of course my mom. And these people felt that I was using my position. Whatever, they kept saying, this guy is too clever, he's going to defraud us, you know. This is a ruse for him to sell this property. And, you know, for whatever reason, I tried to explain, I couldn't. My cousins, many of them understood. But there are specific ones who even claimed that they had gone to witch doctors, that this cancer was not normal, that it was because of witchcraft. But of course, I know this is a normal
thing.
These are normal things. So, you know, I don't have a problem with that. So as we speak now, I stopped doing that project. Because I thought, I've got my own property.
Why don't
let let me just concentrate on what is mine. That will be sorted out by the future, whoever will be. So I think that is how, those were very low moments for sure. Yes, very, very low moments.
Richard's life today is not as good as he wants it to be, but as a man, he continues to do everything he can to stand up for his pride, and also says that his life is very long and full of lessons that will benefit everyone.
Now let me take you, this is my father. My father was in the Second World War. This is in Moshi.
Oh,
this is in Moshi after they had just come from Burma. They were now being demobilized to come back. He fought.
It was an army.
Yeah, he was an army driver.
Oh.
In the Second World War. Burma, Madagascar, Burma. And then they came to Moshi, they were demobilized. Then now he came.
We talk about World War.
World War II.
What?
Yeah, from 39 to when he came back in 45.
Oh my goodness.
Yes. That is me when I joined for my Then these are my grandparents. They are,
in his book, he has a compelling message to share with all. It's not just a personal account, but a treasure trove of wisdom he wishes to impart to the world.
The book is here. Now, as I said, a lot of people wanted to know, have a hand out certain things in life. They wanted to know, how I look so positive when I'm with so many problems, both health and financial. What makes me tick? And I thought, talking about it, after a while, I decided to be posting it on first Facebook. Actually, this book was graduate. So I'd give a sermon, so to speak, on Facebook about a certain topic, how to handle your health. Because after that, I did a lot of reading, I did a lot of research on lifestyle diseases, on diabetes, on cancer, on you name it. And I came up with a lot of information. So what I would do is on Facebook, I'd go to my page and, today maybe put a certain lesson. And then because now, after people read on Facebook, they would now engage me. That's when I decided to put it in a book. And that's how, through the wilderness of life. And that's why I talk about through the wilderness of life, because it is a wilderness. I've gone through a number of things, which the readers of the book will read, will get to know. And I'm open to have a conversation once you know what you want to know from me. Now, this book, I've donated very many copies. I've donated to some schools. I've donated to my primary school. I've donated to Alliance High School. I've donated to people who are unwell so that they can read. I've donated to people. If you go to my YouTube channel, you'll find me talking about some people that have given the book, because I want the information to get to people. But it costs to print the book. What I would want, and this is one of the things that I was also telling my friends, I am in the process of registering a foundation in honor of my parents to help in raising funds so that I can help people with cancer, I can pay school fees for kids, I can feed some kids in some very, very dry areas where I come from. And I'm hoping the sales of this book will be able to finance that. The only way to finance is if a lot of people can buy it. Now, I'm just imagining, if I've been donating them, why can somebody actually come to think of it? Some of my neighbors have donated books also. There's one who paid for 10 books and told me to give to whoever I want. There's another friend of mine who paid for another 5. There's a former student of Alliance High School who is my friend who lives in New York. He paid for 20, and I would share them to people. Now, I'm just wondering, if anybody who is listening to me, if you feel you can afford to pay for this book, 2,300 shillings.
Put in dollars?
Say
$20?
$20, something like that. Yes. If you can afford to give $20, this book will reach more people. And one of the things I can guarantee you is the people who need to read this book actually cannot afford it. So my request, my hope, my plea, and that's why also I'm having the foundation, so that we can actually get this information to reach to the people who need it most. And then once they get the information, how can we help them? That is the other thing, that would be the second step, that you can get help this way to do the following, and this is how you go about it. So this is a kind of, let's do this. Let's get people to read this book.
And it's not a very, it's not just a simple pen, I was thinking.
Richard's experiences, hardships, and resilience he's shown can offer insights and inspiration to those who encounter his words.
I have it online. It's on Amazon. There's a link where people in the US, in the UK, in fact, I've sold some in Japan. I think I saw some yens coming through. There are some people in Australia. So I can be able to give you the link where you can buy the book. It is both soft copy and hard copy. You can get it printed. So that is something that you can buy from wherever you are. You'll be able to buy this book and get people to read it.
Since now we are international, let's just tell these people our email address, and we're going to also to put the link of the book. You can say your Facebook, your email address, and then we're going to put the link on this.
Okay, the easiest way to get to me is to go to Facebook and search The Duke of Emali. You can get The Duke of Emali. I have a page on Facebook. I have an Instagram page. I use the same, Duke of Emali. R. Kiundi, Duke of Emali. So Facebook, I'm on Instagram, I'm on TikTok, I'm on LinkedIn. Basically, that is the social media that I'm on. My email address is rkiundi@gmail.com. You can also get on me on email. You can get me on my Kenyan number. It's 254-722-516-548. Yes, you can get me on any of those. I will be able to link you. I send the link where you can get the books themselves.
His story is a testament to the enduring spirit of the human will, and he hopes that his book will serve as a source of motivation and guidance for anyone who reads it.
You would enjoy reading this book and mine.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
You're welcome, Amy.
It's now my book. I have it.
My name is Jordan Sullivan. Thank you so much for watching today's video on Afrimax English. We truly appreciate your support. If you enjoyed what you saw and want to stay updated with our latest content, please hit that subscribe button down below. And if you're already subscribed, a big thank you. We'll see you in the next video. Until then, take care.